Okay, so we very recently learned about the Morgan's Laws. Before I'm going to start the next topic, I just want to briefly do one exercise. So again, the idea here is that you should stop the video, do the exercise yourself, and then check that you get the same as I do. Okay, so let's use the Morgan's Law to simplify the following Boolean equation. F naught is equal to A and not B, or AC. So F is equal to A not B or AC. I'm just going to introduce parentheses, put a bar over everything. Then I'm going to sort of do this step by step because I find that more convenient. So essentially apply the Morgan's Law once, the OR, so this is A and not B not, and AC not. I'm going to apply it again. Then this becomes not A or B and not A or not C. I can multiply this out to get A bar or A bar B or A bar C bar or B C bar, which I can also write as A bar and one or B or C bar, which of course one or anything is one. So this is just A bar or B C bar. Okay, that was just a quick reminder of the Morgan's Law. Good, so what I really want to talk about today is circuit timing behavior. So up here we have an example of a circuit diagram presented of AND, OR, and NOT gates, and of course so far we've sort of treated this as being completely equivalent to the corresponding Boolean equation. And logically it is, but in practice gates take a certain time to actually execute. So basically every gate has a time constant associated with it, and so even if when the inputs change, A and B, this change will not immediately propagate, for example in this case, to D. And this delay is sort of referred to as a gate delay. So to make this concept clear, I've drawn this timing diagram at the bottom here. So each two lines, or the gap here between two lines, that is one gate delay. And this is typically on the order of 1 nanosecond. And for now, we'll assume that every gate, like AND, OR, and NOT, all have the exact same gate delay, which of course is not quite true, but sort of allows us to, you know, understand the concept and its consequences. Okay, so the basic idea is that given your current input values, you can't know what the current output values are of the gate. You can only know what the output values will be one gate delay later, right? So here in this representation, the thick line sort of represents the current value of a variable. So A starts out 0, then goes up to 1, B remains 1 throughout the whole calculation, and C remains 0. So the first thing we want to calculate is the value of D. As I said, we know what the current values are of A and B, but we can't know what the current value of D is, and I'm just going to represent this stuff like that. Because to know what D is, we kind of need to know what it was one gate delay before. So the first thing we can know about D is what its value in this time interval is, because we can calculate that by looking at these two values. So 0 and 1 is of course 0, and from here we can go here, still remains 0. Now A changes, but of course D doesn't change quite yet, because we are calculating D based on these two values here, and it's only after one gate delay that we can say now A 1 and 1 is 1, so D goes up. And then it kind of stays up, since neither A or B change going forward. Okay, so this change here sort of propagated with one gate delay into here. We can do a similar analysis for E. So E is effectively the OR of D or C, and E remains low up to here and then goes up and stays 1. And again, this change propagates to here. And in fact, even though I drew this as being low, I actually don't know what the value of E is for the first two gate delays, because the signal kind of has to propagate through the circuit and it follows D with one gate delay. And similarly, F follows, which is just the inverse of E, just follows with one gate delay here to here. And again, of course, now for the first three time units, I can't know what that value of F is. Okay, so this slide should just sort of get across this idea that gates take some actual finite time to compute, and so signals kind of ripple through circuits gate by gate. Good. So why does this matter? It would actually be really important, as we'll see, in the context of sequential circuits or circuits with feedbacks, but we'll introduce this idea here already. So because of these gate delays, like a circuit that is kind of logically correct can actually go temporarily go into incorrect states, okay? So here we have sort of a toy example where we're trying to design an autopilot controller. Okay, so you have an airplane, there's a co-pilot, there's a pilot, and both the pilot and co-pilot can request, can put in an autopilot request. Okay, obviously the goal is to sort of build this device in such a way that even if there's no pilot or co-pilot in the cockpit right now, the plane is, you know, flown by somebody, so specifically the autopilot. So let's see if this works, right? So again, if you see a line sort of at the top of the variable name, that represents a 1. If it's at the bottom, that value is a 0. Okay, and we sort of want to go through and find the values of A, B, C, and AE, which is sort of the autopilot engaged variable. Okay, so here I'm saying A starts high. What is A? A is just the inverse of pilot in charge. So at some point here, the pilot decides to leave the cockpit. And so with one gate delay, because of this not gate, A will go up. And nothing else changes going forward, so we just have this. Now B is what? B is the AND of this signal A and the co-pilot's autopilot request. So in this case, the co-pilot has already switched to autopilot. He doesn't, well, I don't know what he's doing, but he's not there. And so B, being the AND of A and CAR, will follow A with one gate delay. Okay, so it's going to go up once both A and CAR are 1. Okay. Now C is an AND gate of pilot in charge and pilot autopilot request. So this is high initially and then goes low. Autopilot request is high. So C stays high initially and then drops down at this point because of this change. Okay, so now finally autopilot engaged is the OR of these signals B and C. And what this does is it starts out high obviously, because C is high. It remains high here because C is still high. It remains high again because of this delay, but now C drops down, so both of them are false, so this drops down because of this, stays high. Now B goes up, so this goes up again, and then not much else happens. Okay, so this is the key thing here, that at this point here you essentially get this glitch, right? So the autopilot engaged output, which you'd like to be high all the time if nobody else is flying the plane, actually goes through a state where it's low, even if just for one gate delay, right? And the reason for this is actually sort of intuitive to understand. It's because you have a signal here, pilot in charge, that impacts on this autopilot engaged through two different paths. It goes up here, and that path has three gate delays. While the path down here only has two gate delays. So the signal sort of arrives at the output with sort of a out of phase with itself. Okay? So this is an example of why this timing actually matters. And of course you could argue that, okay, in this particular example, you know, if literally nobody flies the plane for a nanosecond, it's who cares, right? The plane is going to be fine. But the issue were that if this is a feedback circuit, a sequential circuit, where you take the output signal and you feed it back into the same circuit without any sort of filtering, then this error will propagate and create new errors, and potentially these errors can become very dramatic, okay? And so here I just want to make the point that gate delays exist and that somehow we have to take into account this physical reality. Later on in the sequential circuit section, we'll actually see how we can deal with these types of errors.